The following is a recording of Greenville Presbyterian Theological Seminary. For more information, visit gpts.edu.
Very good. Appreciated your post the other day, Caleb. I don't know if you were in class when Hannah opened the door so I could talk about the stuff we shouldn't be doing on social media.
Oh, yeah.
All right, Philippians 2. Therefore, if there's any encouragement in Christ, if there's any consolation of love, if there's any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and compassion, make my joy complete by being of the same mind, maintaining the same love, united in spirit, intent on one purpose. Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourselves. Do not merely look out for your own personal interest, but also for the interest of others. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus. So, as he's calling us here to put aside selfishness and conceit, to be humble, regard others more highly than ourselves, don't look out for ourselves, but for others, he sets Christ before us in his humiliation and exaltation, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant, and being made in the likeness of men. Being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. For this reason also God highly exalted him, and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee will bow of those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. We'll be looking at various concepts from that chapter today. Lord willing, let us pray. Almighty and glorious God, Father, Son, and Spirit, we look unto you with adoration, faith, love, worship. We bless your holy name because to you alone belongs power, honor, glory, and dominion. We thank you for your kindness to us in Christ. We thank you that you chose us from eternity and delivered us by him in time and in our own time, called us by your Spirit. Lord, as we make our way now from the punishment of sin through the covenant free will in Christ, we ask that your Spirit will continue to enable us to deal with these truths in an intelligent and biblical manner, to be gripped by their truthfulness and affected by them in our lives. We continue to pray for Justin's little girl, Lord, that you will bless the surgery and also enable her to sleep so that Miss Linus's also may rest. Let her sleep and eat, Father. So we look to you now in Christ's name. Amen. All right. We're going to get close to getting caught up tonight, maybe. Although with all the energy in the room, they're telling me what's going to happen tonight. That's all right. Because you get tests on it whether I covered or not. So
I have a question
with that in mind.
I have a question about positive love.
Okay, let me do something else first. You're joking.
I have a teaser.
All right, let me talk some. I promised some people I'd talk some about your assignment, which is really, don't make it difficult. I would hope that all of y'all know how to teach. You probably have been tested some on that from your churches before you came. So I want you to outline your chapter, but then I want you to take that outline and prepare from that a Bible class, Sunday school class, for say high school, college age, or up. And present it any way that you want to present it. There's no right or wrong, as long as you're clear. I want to see scripture. I'd like to see outside sources you'd recommend. If you want to get really creative and have a teaching plan where you would have some discussion questions, open-ended questions, small groups or whatever, there's no right or wrong as long as you exercise a grasp of that chapter, some of the parallel literature, and some creativity, which might be hard for some of you. So now questions, if I've been as clear as mud.
Is this to be over one session or can it be over many?
you don't want to wear out a church. I mean, if you're going to study the confession, I guess it would depend on your chapter. If you had this chapter, 8, you might want to do 2. But just put it in 1. You're not worried about, we're not going to worry about time concepts, okay? When you teach it, you can worry about how you want to divide it up. That's a good question.
You're not actually making us teach it, though, right?
No, pastor, I'm not making you teach it.
I'm an intern, Dr. Pipa. I was just reminiscing on that fact this morning after the presbytery visitation came. Any problems? I just said, look, boys, I'm an intern.
Whoa.
That's smart.
Passing the buck for sure. I heard you were the pastor.
I think you heard something very wrong. And I don't know if you talked to my candidates and credentials committee, but I guarantee that didn't come from them.
Is this the same presbytery that my good friend Sam tried to get into?
No, I'm in Atlantic. Sam was in Great Lakes School.
Okay, well, my good friend Mr. Martin is up in your presbytery, right? In New York?
Bruce or Paul?
Bruce.
Bruce is in New Jersey. He's an hour away from my congregation.
Well, I call it New York. I'm a Southerner. It's all blends together. He's been a friend a long time. All right. No, Mr. Intern, you don't have to teach it. But I hope it would be worth teaching. Because we're going to share them. So remember that as well now. You're going to share your outlines, and at least people have your ideas of how to teach this material so that, Lord willing, at the end of the day, we'll have a halfway decent course, better than this one.
This assignment is due at the end of the semester, right?
Yes, it is due the last Friday of the semester at 5 p.m. Another thing, of course, this is more for the people out there and MP3. When I said in that there, read the Institutes or other suggested books, there's no other suggested books till you get down to Witherow and Murray, as far as I know. So I thought that was clear enough that it's the Institutes I want you reading till you get there. Well, y'all as well. You just want to write about it.
Is there a particular format for the outline, or just, I mean, like the space?
Well, I like the, I prefer the Harvard Outline Series as you've got it how I do it, you know. And everything must have a parallel. So if you've got a Roman numeral 1, you got to have 2. Got an A, got at least a B. Don't have 1 hanging out by itself. We don't like what we read. If you prefer bullet points, okay. But consistently would be better if we're going to try to merge this. But if you're more comfortable working with bullet points for you as teachers and later preachers, the Harvard Outline is a great way to make sure that all of your thoughts, see the descending order is always checking your logic and the cohesiveness of what you're doing. And that's why we teach this outline. You'll have to use it in homiletics, so you might as well get accustomed to it. So it's just very, because one of the purposes is, as was said today in chapel, the better the outline, the better flow there is. That's not just for the congregation, that's for you. The hardest sermons I ever have to preach are the ones I'm never quite convinced I've got it put together in the most biblically logical way out of that text. I've got a good outline, you know, I'm just so much more liberty. Any more questions? Yes, sir.
I just want to make sure I heard right. So this is the Harvard outline for the layout?
That's what it's called. Okay. This is what I showed you. So yeah. It's just Roman numerals, caps, lower numbers, smaller case numbers, and then 1 parenthesis, 2 parenthesis. Assume that's what Mr. Cook's doing in rhetoric, but probably should touch base with him to be sure.
question, but it doesn't have anything to do with the lesson plan.
All right, we finished with the assignment, okay.
I'd asked you about what fill means in the outline.
Yeah.
You said ask next week.
Okay.
I didn't do that.
Phil is the Philadelphia Confession. So that's in here for the Reformed Baptist. That's the American confession that the London Confession of 1681 was then adopted over here. They made the same kind of changes in the Baptist Church that the Presbyterians made with respect to the civil magistrate and some things like that. But that's a good resource. That's what Southern Seminary used when they were formed and what they still use now. By the way, we've got a birthday boy. Should we sing? Stand up.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Fabio. Happy birthday to you.
Woo-hoo! Now, as long as you didn't read on Facebook, guess his age. You can't, you're not allowed to guess if you saw it posted on Facebook, but
16.
18?
31.
Doesn't look 31. He's a practicing lawyer, you know, so don't get him on your wrong side. Happy birthday. And Eduardo's birthday is today, but he was in here last year, so I didn't catch it. I don't always look at those birthdays on Facebook. They please me when I do. All right. Anything else? Any other back last week's questions? So we worked through providence and sin and the church and then the fall, total depravity. It's a great quotation in Calvin's Institutes of the definition of total depravity. If you've not found that, it's worth looking for. I don't have it marked down here. All right, so I think we're at the punishment now for sin. We talked about the remnant of sin that's yet in Christians, and that's pardoned by Christ, and the old nature is mortified. But it's still sin. So paragraph 6, every sin, both original and actual, being a transgression of the righteous law of God, and contrary thereunto, doth in its own nature bring guilt upon the sinner, whereby he's bound over to the wrath of God and curse of the law, and so made subject to death with all misery, spiritual, temporal, and eternal. And then a little different in larger catechism, lost communion with God, his displeasure and curse, so as we are by nature children of wrath, bond slaves of Satan, and justly liable to all the punishments. And then the condensed version, the shorter catechism, all mankind by their fall lost communion with God are under his wrath and curse, and so made liable to the miseries of this life, death itself, and the pains of hell forever. So what's the first punishment of sin? Well, before that, I guess you, is the punishment not the proper word, but guilt. And there's a twofold guilt that's been mentioned here. What's the first guilt for which every sinner is responsible? The guilt of Adam's first sin. No other sins by Adam, but we're born guilty of Adam's first sin. And that's something that periodically we should humble ourselves about. And then, of course, we're guilty of all of our own sin. So sin is both original and actual. And by its nature, it is a transgression of the righteous law of God. And, of course, we looked at Shorter Catechism 14. What is sin? Sin is a sin, which means it's better. You can't hurt cats, but anyway. So here we see that it is contrary to the righteous law of God, and by its own nature. So sin, by what it is, brings guilt then upon the sinner. As a consequence of that, there are then the punishments that are mentioned. What are they? We can look at both the catechism and the paragraph 6.
Loss of communion.
All right, loss of communion with God.
Under his wrath and curse.
Under his wrath and curse. Psalm 5. God didn't just hate sin. God hates the sinner. And all those who are not objects of his saving, eternal mercy remain under his wrath, and because of that are under condemnation. What else?
You're enslaved to Satan.
All right, enslaved to Satan. Curse of the law and slaves to Satan. They, in a sense, work together. What else?
All the miseries of this life.
All right. All the miseries of this life, which have to do with all of the evil things in the world. So disease, illness, hurricanes, whatever, personally and corporately. Whatever is a product of the curse of the fall in Genesis chapter 3. And so in one way or another, so I was talking to one of our students, I don't know if it's public yet, so I won't mention names, but his wife is pregnant and very sick. And she's very sick only for one reason, right? And that's the fall. And that was one of the particular curses of the fall. So it's not because she's sinful. God's not punishing her for sin. She's lost a baby, and she didn't lose a baby because of her sin. Now, that can't happen. And if God chastens because of sin, it'll be clear, it won't take a rocket scientist, that whatever affliction comes to us, if it's a chastening, now understand, for a believer, it's not a punishment. Christ has borne all of your guilt, but it can be a chastening. It can be a heart chastening like David. But that's only a very minor reason for afflictions. And that was the mistake that Job's friends, even Job himself, made. So all pain is in the world because of sin. And what else?
Death.
And death is threefold. Subject to death with all misery, spiritual, temporal, and eternal. And that's the three aspects of death with which we have to deal. And so temporal death is coming to all of us unless Christ returns. Spiritual death, we're born dead in our sins and trespasses, Ephesians 2. And then eternal death, or judicial death, and that is the pains of hell forever, as it says in the Shorter Catechism 19. Eternal damnation. Look at the phrase in the Larger Catechism 29. The punishments of sin in the world to come are everlasting separation from the comfortable presence of God and most grievous torments in soul and body without intermission in hellfire forever. Why do you think they use the language comfortable presence?
God's in hell. I mean, you're just subjected to his extreme wrath. It's not comfortable. It's the exact opposite of comfortable.
Just the opposite. So we enjoy God's comfortable presence. People in heaven will enjoy it perfectly. But don't ever get the idea when we talk about separation from God that God is not in hell. He is in hell punishing, because God's everywhere. He won't cease to be everywhere. But it's going to be his wrathful presence in hell, which is so it's a separation from his comfortable presence, which nobody can imagine living without, even the most wretched of sinners. So it's a separation from that. The torments in soul and body. Now it says hell fire forever. Do you think they meant literal fire? got a maybe, I got a yes.
It's likened to fire.
So that means it's not a literal fire. Yeah. I got a no. All right, good. I got a yes, a maybe, and a no. Defend your position.
I would argue yes, because that's what Scripture says. Now, fire is something that's tormenting to us. It's one of the worst experiences we could have. Hell cannot be described merely with the term fire. It's a lot more than that. It's misery beyond description, but that's the closest word that could describe it. But it would involve literal flame, because the bodies of men, both just and unjust, will be raised at the last day.
So then, how's that compatible with absolute utter darkness?
Well, if there can be light without the sun, there can be darkness with fire.
Whoa! who is the maybe back there? There was some fence sitter. Fence sitter. You know what happens if people sit on fences? They get splitters.
Looking specifically at what it says, hell-fire, it seems to me there's something particular about this fire that's not ordinary fire. So that's why I said maybe this fire is particularly hellfire, fire of hell. So just based solely on this and not anything from Scripture. So.
Well, it's a condescending term to help us understand how God is going to deal with the wicked. Something, I mean, I can remember one of the first times I got burned. It was the most horrible. I put my hand on the side of a grill, and they had to scrub my hand afterwards. It was horrible.
Yeah, so it is, I mean, and you were going that direction. So it is a figure that it'll be 10 times worse than physical fire. If it's something... Is there something physical about hell? Yes, there has to be, because it's the body as well as the soul. But right now, it's just the soul in hell. And so the fire of hell has got to be more than physical, because it's the soul that's in hell until the resurrection. So it's something worse than fire as we understand it. Abram?
You kind of answered it. I was going to reference the lake of fire in Revelation.
Right.
Kind of leaning towards it being physical fire. Otherwise, yeah, you kind of answered the question.
So, before the final judgment, when a person dies and they go in the presence of God, are they thrown into hell before that, or are they just experiencing the full wrath of God in his presence?
No, they're in hell. After judgment, they'll be in hell, body and soul, but I think they're immediately in hell.
Okay. So, Dr. Pipa, you
Mr.
don't
Dotson,
subscribe to...
I love a New Jersey with a southern accent, but that's good.
I didn't hear you. My wife was sitting here writing a card out, and I said, what did you say? Forgive me.
No, that's all right. I just said I like a person that lives in a New York area that has a southern accent.
Oh, I'm from Wise County, Virginia.
I know.
Oh, okay. Just kind of understand.
I know where Wise County is.
You do?
Because my son-in-law pastored in Neon for 9.5 years.
Really?
And
I had
a couple of grandchildren that were born over there in Wise County. Dr. Smith told my daughter that she should have her children in Virginia, not in Kentucky. So the next first two were in Kentucky, and the others were born in Virginia.
Every time you cross that mountain from Kentucky into Virginia, you just the level of education, everything. Like, I'm not trying to be, you know, trite about it, but it seems like it gets a little better.
It's Mr. Holy. I mean, Mr. Page.
I know him from my college.
So I know you do. Okay. All right, your question.
Yes, sir. So do you hold, obviously we have an intermediate state of hell, but to follow up on Mr. Morrison's question, are you saying soul is immediately cast into the lake of fire? Because I was under the impression there's an intermediate hell, which Christ describes as like a gnashing of teeth, and then there's a lake of fire, which is the final hell, which has not yet been, for lack of a better word, created.
I have never thought about that. I take the parable of a rich man and Lazarus, and I know it's a parable, but I think that it still puts the souls only in one place. You're like a dispensationalist trying to put the souls of the righteous in some kind of holding chamber. Actually, they have a double holding chamber, don't they? They've got a holding chamber for the wicked, some punishment, and a holding chamber for the... I could be wrong. Have anybody else heard about an intermediate hell?
Well, it's
not a covenant or doctrine?
No, I think I got it from Rob McCurley. He was talking about an intermediate state of heaven, because the new heavens and the new earth have not yet been brought about, and an intermediate state of hell, because the lake of fire had not yet been brought about.
Well, it's okay. Hell, in terms of the punishment, it's not an intermediate state. It's the punishment of the soul. Is there going to be a final construction of hell like heaven? I've not thought so. The intermediate state of the believers in the presence of Christ. So the intermediate state of the unbeliever would be away from the comfortable presence of God. And I don't think it does us a lot of good to try to say, well, is that some other location? Maybe it's not as designed yet for the body. I don't know, but I don't. I just think in terms of they're away from the comfortable presence of God, under His wrath and torment.
So right. Yes, sir. I don't think that there's any distinction. At least my understanding is the intermediate hell is still as wrathful and still has, you know, terrible torments on the soul. Just I was under the impression the lake of fire was that which was to come, as it were. But well, I
you know, we know that the new heavens are going to come down to earth, but I don't know we have any place in Scripture that says that the lake of fire has yet to be constructed. That's what I'm saying. But I'm glad you asked the question, because I've never thought about it. And I'm going to research it. And you research it.
How does this relate to what we're talking about here, relate to the judgment seat, where we're told that there will be, Christ will separate the sheep from the goats, and the one will be welcomed into His presence forever, and the other will be cast.
That's the final judgment in our body state.
Yes.
So
but
there's no, I mean, when the bodies of the wicked are raised and reunited to their souls, they're immediately going to be on Christ's left hand. And then there's going to be the public judgment to take place.
So we're saying now that they are condemned before they've had the public judgment.
Oh, yeah. They're condemned at death. And again, I think that teaching of Christ in Luke of the rich man and Lazarus, other places. I mean, I don't see a distinction between the gnashing of teeth and eternal torment of fire, though. I think gnashing of teeth is one way to talk about the pains of hell. So you were going a bit beyond the nature of the torment in your intermediate hell. Right? It's not
going beyond the nature of torment.
You said you always thought that the gnashing of teeth was intermediate hell, and that the really bad hell was going to take place after the return of Christ.
If I said that, I actually didn't mean to convey that, because I believe, like, when the Lord Jesus is talking about it, He uses the term sort of interchangeably. I think I got this idea partially from Rob McCurley and partially from John Gershner, who has, I think, a four-part series on hell on Sermon Audio.
Yeah. And he's building off of Edwards. All right, that's good. Good question. Regardless, are you satisfied?
Yeah.
Okay.
Dr. Pipa.
Yes, sir.
Looking at the text, it does say that in Revelation 20, death and hell, or Hades, were thrown into the lake of fire. I think that's what Zach is referring to.
Well, Hades there, I think, has to do with the burial of the dead as the place of, as that's punishment as well.
Okay.
Now, it could be, it could be something else, but that's how I've always understood it, that we discussed it in the last class, that Hades and hell are always used negatively. So even in the Psalms, Hades looks at death and burial as always in connection with the curse and punishment of sin. And that's why it's used both for burial and for the grave. It's always the grave in terms of the grave of the wicked, though, and hell. I think not. That was obviously a literal fire that consumed flesh, whereas the hellfire is not going to consume flesh. All right, good. And then to go back to 28, what are the punishments of sin in this world? This just expands on that. Are either inward, blindness of mind, a reprobate sense, strong delusions, hardness of heart, horror of conscience, and vile affections. This explains the, quote, atheist and the hardened sinners, the deluded. These are all punishments of God to those that harden themselves in sin. So blindness, a reprobate sense, which is just a hatred of God. Strong delusions, which are all error, and you hear things that people believe and you wonder how in the world does a sane, logical person even follow such a belief or philosophy, because God's given them over to that. And hardness of heart, which we talked about before, is you harden your heart, God will harden your heart. And then horror of conscience and vile affections. Horror of conscience. The old writers said that in Isaiah it talks about the worm that eats and never consumes his conscience. So that in hell, the conscience is like a worm. It'll be gnawing and gnawing and gnawing. It'll remind you of every prayer, every gospel sermon, every plea, every conviction. And you're constantly reminded in your conscience of all the things that God did in your life to call you to himself, and he refused. And you'll never forget them. And then vile affections, I think that speaks a good bit to what's happening. I mean, what Paul says in Romans chapter 1. A culture given over to homosexuality is given over to vile affections. And so we need to understand where we are. As a culture, we've been given over to God's wrath. Punishment. Yes, sir.
With thinking about the attitude of the unbeliever in hell, wouldn't it be an unrepentant attitude?
Mm-hmm.
But with, so repentance, correct me if I'm wrong, would be not having the feeling of regret over what they've done. So how does that correlate?
Repentance and regret are different, as Paul points out in 2 Corinthians. Regret can be a sinful, selfish remorse. True repentance is the grief and hatred of sin. Come in, son.
So they would have the regret, not the repentance.
Right. And they hate God for it. So part of the eternity of hell is the fact that they're going to continue sin.
But with the difference between misery and punishment, obviously God has decreed both of them. The catechism makes a distinction there. Does it have to do with how God is acting through those things, or are they largely synonymous? Or it seems to me that everything that's a misery is could just as easily be said to have been a punishment. So,
yeah, made liable to all miseries in this life, this is the estate whereinto all men fell. So the miseries of this life are to all men. When we are redeemed in Christ, We're not necessarily redeemed from the miseries of this life, but there's no longer, evil can no longer touch us.
So the elect would still experience, when they've been called effectually, they'd still experience the misery but not the punishments.
Right.
Okay.
No wrath or curse. Okay, so it's a sobering reality, and we should reflect on it, recognize that if God had not shown us grace and mercy, that's where we would have a blindness of mind, a reprobate sense, strong delusions, hardness of heart, horror of conscience, and vile affections, and headed straight to hell with no hope. Seen that. That's not the only vile affection.
Okay, so in, so my, so I'm using that as an example to state my question as best as I can. My question is over temptation. So is temptation a vile affection? Is
temptation is not a sin.
Okay, so even a homosexual, so if somebody says, if there's a repenting homosexual who's still attracted to somebody of the same sex.
Attraction is sin. It's not a temptation. That's the lie they're distributing right now.
Okay. So could you
same-sex attraction is not temptation. It is a perversion of character that is sinful.
So could you define for me more clearly the line? So what is exactly temptation, and why is it not sinful? Whereas, so if I have, like, if
well, the Bible says it's not. I mean, Christ was tempted in all points as we are, yet without sin. We know that temptation is in itself not sin. You know, Luther illustrated. He said, "You can a bird can fly over your head, but you don't allow it to nest in your hair." So, temptation is the bird flying over your head. The nesting is giving into it. William Perkins worked out in his commentary in Galatians, and actually it's in my commentary in Galatians as well, then copied from him, is the stages, and if I can remember off the top of my head, the first is a temptation to a lust that would not in itself be sin, but if there, and it would be strongly resisted in a true Christian, but then if there's some, if that lust becomes somewhat attractive, that's the first step of sin. And then you give over to the practice, and then you become to the committing of it, and then you go over to the practice of it. And that basically parallels what James says in James chapter 1.
That's actually, the James chapter 1 verse is actually the second part of my question, because in some translation it says evil desires, and another translation it just says desires.
Well, neither one's a good translation. Each one is tempted, which is carried away, enticed by his own lust. Lust is sin. Lust of the eyes, lust of the flesh, boastful pride of life. That's the three lusts that were born in Eve's heart in the garden. That's the three lusts then that is described as worldliness and spiritual adultery in 1 John chapter 2. And so lust, you know, the Roman Catholics say concupiscence or concupiscence is not a sin. In other words, for them, lust isn't a sin. It's part of your, that's this whole nature grace schema they have. So your base nature has concupiscence or concupiscence. But the Bible clearly says that lust is a sin. So here's the difference then. A heterosexual can be, either because of the remnant of sin within them, lust, coupled with the world and Satan, or any combination thereof, can be tempted to lust for a person of the opposite sex. That is a lust that's sin, that the temptation is coming in part from within. Job said he made a covenant not to look upon a woman, and by that he means with lust. So let's say that I'm at the gym, and a woman passes by. I've got to make a decision not to take a second look if she's not dressed appropriately. And that's the covenant. I'm not going to put myself in a position, I mean, ideally, where I am not having a wrong kind of attraction. Now, a man may think that another woman is very attractive, and that's not a sin. And a woman may think a man who's not her husband is very attractive, and that's not a sin. It's what we do with those thoughts, either in terms of breaking the 10th commandment or the 7th commandment.
So you're saying if the homosexual, though, it would be a sin?
Yes.
Okay.
Because the Bible tells us that God made them male and female, and they become one flesh. And Paul says that it is the desire of women for women, men for men, that is the part of the vile affection that God is giving mankind over to. So, what all I'm asking of a person with same-sex attraction is repent of it and mortify it and seek God's grace. Whereas they're saying, as long as you don't give in to it, you're not sinning. That's the difference. Whereas, if I'm tempted to lust, that's a sin. But if I look at a woman and think she's attractive, that's not a sin. That's the difference.
So practically, how would that look for a homosexual who, as you say, if you look at a woman and think she's attractive, it's not a sin. If a homosexual looks at somebody of the same sex and thinks they're attractive, and it is a sin, how in practice would you advise that person to mortify that sin? If it's just...
First, admit it's a sin. Repent of it, and ask Christ by His Spirit to change your affections. But I sure wouldn't promote three of these men living together as roommates. That's what they're doing. That's what they promote at this Free Voice Conference. There, you can just have other guys with same-sex attraction roommates. I'm not going to have a non-married woman as a roommate. I just deal with a pastoral situation when I was in New Mexico. And this couple's engaged, but they are not ready to get married, and he's moved into her apartment, but they're staying chaste. And I'm saying, yeah, you don't know your own heart. So you don't put yourself either way into a place of temptation, but that's what they're advocating. And that's just part of the danger of what, I haven't listened to it, but y'all hear, Rick Phillips posted something today, or wrote something on Ref 21, stirred up a good bit of Revoice objection, so that's good. Does anybody know what I'm talking about when I say Revoice? I was going to deal with this when we come to free will, where we're going. So this is a good...
Yeah. Right.
It was at a PCA church, yes. Go over to chapter... This is ideal. Good segue. Go over to the next chapter we have, which is the chapter on free will, chapter 9. You need to understand, if you look at this chapter, that there's nothing wrong with the term. Calvin didn't like it. We understand why he didn't like it. On the other hand, it is an important concept, regardless of what you call it. But notice the very first paragraph. God hath endued the will of man with that natural liberty that it is neither forced nor by any absolute necessity of nature determined to good or evil. And so there's no compulsion. The will is part of being in the image of God. The will is naturally free, made by God to choose between non-essential things as well as between good and evil or moral things. It is not forced. It's not mechanistic. It's not anything outside of you that can force your will. Now, I could hold a gun to your head and compel you or try to get you to do something I want you to do, but I have not affected your free will. You're free to call my bluff or to get shot or to do it. You see the difference? The second one is what I find important today, are any absolute necessity of nature. Now we're talking about the native will. We know that the will in bondage has an internal necessity, but this is saying there's nothing, it's not behaviorism, it's not anything about my genetic DNA that is going to in any way be able to compel my will. You can apply to all kinds of things. So this is why I don't like the idea of alcoholism. You can't go to hell for an illness, right? So if the Bible says that no drunkard inherits the kingdom of heaven, aren't we better off calling them drunkards? That gives them some hope, and it doesn't disguise this. So it's not that I am genetically determined to abuse alcohol. No. We'll all have physical propensities that exercise our wills wrongfully. We can form addictions. But we only form the addiction because we have wrongly exercised our will. It's not that this compulsion to drink and get drunk forced me to act in that manner. You see the difference? Now, I'm applying that today to same-sex attraction. That nobody should be able to say, or should say, legitimately, biblically, that because of who I am genetically, I'm transgender, or I am a lesbian, or I'm a homosexual. When the Bible says those things are sin. So for these guys to say that same-sex attraction is merely a, whatever they want to call it, genetic propensity, or whatever, they're saying the will is under necessity bound. No, there's no hope. They get really upset then when we would say to a person, no, this is a sin, but I tell you that because just so I can tell a drunk that drunkenness is a sin and that in Christ there is release. It might be slow for some, but in Christ there's release. So I can say to the person with same-sex attraction that this is an act of your will. Now, unbelieving psychologists are demonstrating this, the absurdity of a preteen or a teen determining I am a different gender than I am made physically by God. That is an act of the will. And it is going to destroy a lot of people and our culture. So that's where I'm coming from, is that whereas for me to want a woman is a good God-created gift. If I abuse that good God-created gift, I've sinned. But if I choose to use it in the God-given way, I've not sinned. You see the difference?
Dr. P, I just want to clarify, I understood what you just said. So in the state of innocence, no internal or external necessity. In the state of the fall, no external necessity, but...
And no internal necessity in terms of any type of programming inside or outside the person.
Right.
In other words, behaviorism also is wrong. I mean, and that's why if those of you who have studied education, I don't know what's going on right now, but the whole behavioristic approach to education is a violation of man, the image bearer of God, and a violation of the will, because I'm trying to bypass the will and treat you like an animal. So if I keep rewarding your good behavior, you're going to be a good kid. And that's wrong. Now, I can reward good behavior if I do so respecting your will, and your intelligence, and you got to make choices. Rewards are good, but not manipulative rewards. So, yes, even post-fall, no view that there's anything within us or out us, external to our own desires that have been born of sin that can make necessarily force the will.
What would you say then to the passage?
Well, he's talking about mortification of the flesh. You know, he's not talking about literal. Origen took that literally. And Origen had himself castrated. Unfortunately, it in no way helped his lust. It just meant he could no longer take care of his lust by getting married. Christ is using very radical language there that we never expose ourselves to temptation. That's really what he's saying. So again, if I have same sex, or I, as a heterosexual, I'm not going to, you know, what our vice president said, I'm not sure I'd go as far as he went. I'm not going out to a public place to eat, but I'm not going to be in a private place with a another woman that's my wife to whom I'm attracted. That's just stupid. That's when you have to cut it off and kill yourself. Okay? So that's a really, I think, a timely statement with respect to what's going on today. And a prominent Reformed seminary. Teaching same-sex attraction is not sin. You really want to get upset about it. I actually say that you could be a campus worker with RUF and have same-sex attraction. Would you want to send your kids under that campus worker? No, I don't think so. So we're actually, this is the next, one of the next battles we'll have in the Presbyterian Church in America is you're going to ordain a man with same-sex attraction, or a woman. No, that's going to happen too, but maybe someday.
So I guess a final kind of clarifying question with regards to someone who is repentant of homosexuality and homosexual attraction. And what would you do in the case of a person like that who's broken over their sin and they're repentant of it and they don't want to have that kind of desire, but they still are, you know, having the bird fly over
right.
their head, so to speak?
I warmly receive them into the church, treat them, I admit them to the Lord's table, I have them into my home. I try to encourage them. What I don't want to do is take a sin, any sin, and couple the word Christian to it, which is one of the things they've done. I'm a homosexual Christian. Well, no, my identity is in Christ, and then I say Christian, I cannot identify myself by sin. I'm not a fornicating Christian. I'm not a drunken Christian. I'm not an adulterating Christian. The church should warmly receive any repentant homosexual that makes a credible profession of faith and treat them as a brother or a sister. Let them know that in us they've got a safe sounding board when they're struggling, and don't ostracize them from our homes. Now, we don't act foolishly. I would not, early on, leave my children with them. But I think they would appreciate that. Whereas these guys from Metro New York, when we were trying to pass some homosexual resolution at the assembly, so, oh, we have friends, let them babysit our children. Man, that's stupidity. But no, we do, they shouldn't be treated second class. And at that point, if they're wrestling with their lust, no different than I am wrestling with my lust. But we're not going to put a badge on them and say, well, yeah, you're same-sex attracted and you're always going to be that way. Just live chaste.
You mentioned the question of whether somebody with same-sex, a man with same-sex attraction can be ordained. Now, trying to understand and make the parallel between you're saying same-sex attraction, so he's not acting on it, it's just the attraction, he just thinks...
It's a sin, though.
It's a sin, right. You're saying that it's sin. So making a parallel, not with a man who's attracted to a woman, but the fact that he decides to take a second look. So he's decided to lust after her, basically. So I'm making that parallel. Is that accurate?
Mm-hmm. Make this parallel. One of the questions we ask our candidates is, are you using pornography?
Right.
If you're using pornography, you can't be ordained.
Struggle to not take a second look. So why priest, would that man be able to be ordained?
Because he's struggling. Same sex, they're not struggling. They said, this is who I am, accept me.
But I'm saying, okay, so not that person.
Well, that's the person, that's where you started, though. If I say I'm wrestling with this, I'm going to want to see some maturity if they've been a practicing homosexual.
Right.
But no, if it's a sin they're wrestling with,
right,
and they admitted it's sin, that's very different.
Okay,
I'm talking about the person, these people are saying that same-sex attraction is not a sin and they should be ordained.
Okay, so they're allowed to continue actively feeling attracted.
Yes.
Okay, that was where I had my confusion.
That's what same-sex attraction means.
So
it's being used.
It's
not the struggle.
It's not, okay, so it's not that somebody who is struggling the same way that a man might struggle.
Right.
Okay.
Is it possible for some of these people that they are mislabeling or misinterpreting attraction when friendship has been a major part of human life for as long as men have been around?
Unfortunately,
as sexual attraction,
unfortunately, these people are trying to make it that way, but they're saying more. So they'll say that David and Jonathan weren't just close friends, but they maybe had an attraction to one another. Any sane person knows the difference between a warm male-male or female-female friendship and being sexually attracted to that person. So, no. They're saying you can be special friends, but that's where they're playing with fire. Not literal fire.
is that like friends with benefits?
No, fringe benefits.
Thunder Piper.
Mr. Dotson.
Just a question about this revoice thing. I said it was a PCA thing, and what I was wondering about when I said that was, I was under the impression it was held at a PCA church to intentionally kind of push that movement into the PCA, and it was organized by PCA people. So if I'm wrong about that, I'd like to know. I'd like to understand it in its context.
As best as I understand it, it was not organized by PCA people, but this church hosted it and is favorable toward it. So there's a movement afoot now asking that presbytery to investigate that church's involvement. Okay. Who else is that up there now?
I'm here.
Stephen. Hey, Stephen.
Yes.
I thought you sent me a written. You don't have to do that when you're online.
I never know when I'm actually going to join.
Oh, okay.
Depends on how the meetings are going. So.
Well, I was asking Mrs. Holmes today, exactly where do you live?
I live in Colorado.
Okay. Very good. You staying away from the cannabis?
Yes, I am doing my best.
Okay. You're struggling with it, huh? Okay. This is important. This is why I wanted to go to this direction, because this is going to be one of the number one issues in my denomination for sure. But it's not just limited to the PCA. I think you're going to have advocates of it in the OPC and RPCNA or whatever. Mark, you've been quiet tonight. I've asked all the questions.
Okay. If a person is struggling with homosexual desire, but he admits it's a sin and he constantly mortify it, and would it be proper, or say he's a man, would it be proper to ordain him?
I said, a lot would be how far removed he's been
okay
from the practice. But if he's manifested a chastity and a genuine repentance, yeah. Now, Bebo Elkin and I worked with a young man, and we were convinced that he was chaste and had put off his old lifestyle. And I participated in his ordination. And then we got word a few months later that he had fallen. And I actually got in my car in Texas and drove to Mississippi, and Bebo and I met with him and demanded he immediately resign from the ministry. So we probably, you know, that many years ago, there were a lot of things that I was just kind of probably too trusting about that I would not be now. Another one would be child abuse. So a man repents and he appears to be converted. That doesn't mean he has been. So that's why we have to be very slow and careful on any life-dominating sin. And I would put homosexuality with drug abuse, drunkenness, pornography in this category of life-dominating sin.
Rosaria Butterfield.
Yeah.
Her ideas about ministering to homosexuals, including hospitality. Your perspective on that?
Come next Monday night.
Tuesday.
You're going to be free to come Monday night to the book discussion? Is that just for Wednesday?
Tuesday.
I mean Tuesday. Actually, I'm going to let y'all out 30 minutes early. Everybody has to go. Is that just for the ladies?
I don't know. I'll need to check.
Do you know? We want the ladies to read the book, so maybe it's just for ladies. But yeah, I'm going to deal with that there. So, I don't want to tip my hand too soon. I'll answer that later.
My question will continue to be not what we don't do with homosexuals, but what do we do?
One of the places I have, I agree with her distinction of, it's two words, I can accept and not approve, I think are the two words that she uses. And I agree with that with a non-Christian. I can accept them as a person, but not approve. But then she goes on to say that she's willing then to deal with them on their own terms. And so she's learned whether they're mom or mommy, and I could never use, to me that moves over to acceptance if I start recognizing a homosexual marriage by the terminology that I'm using in that relationship. So that's one of the areas. In terms of an openness of our home, yes, but don't be naive. I think she's naive. I think George Scipione had a person with them that did bless one of his children. So we just have to be wise with little children. Particular, and make sure older children know that regardless of what threats are given to them, and you should tell your children this anyway, it doesn't matter what this person has said, you know, they can't hurt mommy and daddy and they can't hurt you if you'll come to us and immediately tell us if anybody touches you inappropriately anytime, any place. So yeah, I think you've got to be wise. Now we're talking about the unconverted. And she does address that in the book. Did I answer your question sufficiently?
Yeah, it's a good start.
Are you scratching your head or are you raising your hand?
Just scratching my head.
Actually. The head to scratch.
How do you balance?
You just
what, Mr. Dotson?
I dealt with this issue actually. I had a couple show up in my church and they were talking about homosexuality, and I really kind of put the pedal to the floor and I said, look, this is a grievous thing, it's a sin that's at the end of the society, and I said these people will not hold back from forcing us to go along with their agenda, and well, it was kind of a shame. They've not returned, and I subsequently found out they had a homosexual family member. But I didn't know that at the time, and it was hard because they really felt that if we just loved and accepted and didn't really condemn it, then we would have some standing with them. can't really see that to be the case. I think they're quite dangerous.
Yeah, we have to, I would say that probably, and now you're not talking as an intern because it's your church, so I would say that you maybe passively weren't as wise as you ought to be, intern. Particularly when you don't know people. Questions are better at that point and find out what's going on. So you can bring them along and help them understand. And that, one of the big compromises you are seeing, or even professing Christians, are compromising because of some family member. And they've got to understand that this is a reprehensible sin. And Paul says that the homosexual does not go to heaven. That's the practicing homosexual. One of the other problems is the kind of hypocrisy double standard that we've had in the culture and in the church. So the seventh commandment is, thou shalt not commit homosexuality, thou shalt not commit adultery. And the church has, in many of its forms, allowed adultery and fornication to go without church discipline. It was a very cynical joke in California, but in Calvary chapels, they had a lot of divorces, and the divorce time was which Calvary chapel each person got to go to. Because they both would stay, they couldn't stay in the same church, but they both would want to stay in the Calvary chapel, and so they go to different ones. And it's the same in the world, you know, for a long time, you put up with all this, and suddenly you're screeching about homosexuality. You don't have a right to do that. Adultery, in God's sight, is worse. And I say that because I think each of the Ten Commandments takes the worst of the sins that are all included in that commandment. Because it's violating a covenant contract, vow till death do us part. So no-fault divorce and all these things that have just simply snowballed in our society, of course God gives us over to these other perversions. But they're the end of the day. Hannah?
Who is calling himself a Christian and in a homosexual relationship, and there needs to be a hard stance against that. Sin is sin, it's egregious. But I also feel a certain level of compassion for the repentant struggling with same-sex attraction because of the attitude that he gets from fellow Christians when he is indeed struggling and repentant. Why and how, I guess my question is this, how can we show a struggling homosexual, truly repentant, struggling homosexual?
Well, if he's married with children, he's got the cure in his hands. Why do people know he's struggling?
So the people who do know because of his past.
Well, he, okay.
And so what I'm
he was a homosexual, he converted, he got married.
Right. So it's like a stigma, right? It's like a mark on somebody. It's one of those things.
That is wrong.
Right. So how can we avoid that? Is my question. As future ministers and as congregation members, how can we actively communicate to the struggling homosexual and make the example for others to not stigmatize it? It while recognizing that it is a sin and it needs to be dealt with as sin, but that it's not like some kind of different mark on you because.
Right.
You had that particular struggle.
It's another red H. That was the red A. And I think that that's probably where Rosaria Butterfield's first book would be useful as well. The church needs to be mature about this as well. It's going to have to start the top down. Pastors and elders need to treat this couple equal with every other couple. and openly affirm them in their marriage and in their family. And he should be plugged into a godly man to whom he's accountable weekly, so that he is demonstrating growth in that area. And he should pray that God would give him increased delight in his wife. And she should do all she can to, so if you have her ear, it's up to her to be attractive, and if you, ladies, please excuse me, seduce his pants off of him. I mean, she's got an important role to help turn in his affections the direction they should be. Are you blushing?
No. I had another question for that, but I'll just ask you at another time because I think otherwise I'll dominate.
Okay. You're not giving Mark much time tonight. So
can I ask?
I don't know. Can you? Does the mouth work?
If a man, he continues to mortify the sin of homosexual desire, but somehow he, at this point, just cannot have any lawful desire for a woman, should he still pursue marriage?
Mm-mm. No, Paul does say that some have the gift of singleness.
But does he? Is it equal? This situation equal to a gift of singleness, or?
Well, that's how Paul explains it. If you are lusting for a woman, it's better to get married than to burn.
Yeah, but he's burning. I mean, he's burning, but he's just not burning for a woman. Still have the.
Well, he's got to deal with that. But I mean, he should try to channel his affections. He should never marry a woman to whom he's not attracted. That would not be fair to her. So, but he should try to cultivate. Ask God for it. And I don't know that God gives that to every man, but he can surely deliver him from the other. So you basically got the person who begins to have an attraction for women, or a woman for a man, and then you'll have those that God can help put to death the same-sex attraction, but has never given them heterosexual attraction either. All right, well, we're exercising our free will. Paragraph 2. What larger catechism is any man able perfectly to keep the commandments of God? No man is able either of himself or of any grace received in this life perfectly to keep the commandments of God, but doth daily break them in thought, word, and deed. So what we have now in the catechism are the four states of the will. So we have able to sin, unable not to sin, able not to sin, unable to sin. So the pre-fall state was able not to sin. The fallen state is not able not to sin. The regenerate state is able not to sin. And the glorified state is not able to sin. And that's these next four paragraphs. Mr. Morrison.
Aren't we going into covenant? The covenant, chapter 7?
I think I skipped it. We'll go back to the covenant. But okay. Since we went into this, I just thought we'd stay here.
I got my notes and I was all kinds of confused.
I'm sorry.
So.
It was easier. We can go back if you want to. But I just thought since we were here, we'd do it. And it does flow out of depravity as well.
Okay.
So understand then, we talk about free will, we're not talking about an autonomous will. And the best way to define the will is the soul's self-determining nature. The soul's self-determining nature. That's going to be influenced by the intellect and by the affection. So if the mind is blinded and the heart hates God, then we see what the soul's self-determining nature, how it's going to act. Before the fall, though, man in his state of innocency had freedom and power to will and do that which was good and well-pleasing to God, but yet mutably, so that he might fall from it. So God made man with this free will, not in any way forced or under absolute necessity of nature, but mutable. Of course, that was part of God's plan, because God had foreordained the fall. And he wanted, in the plan, man is to be responsible for his actions. But after that, if you say the soul is a self-determining, free will is a self-determining nature of the soul, and the soul is then affected by intellect and affections, man by us fall into a state of sin, hath wholly lost all ability of will to any spiritual good accompanying salvation. So as a natural man, being altogether averse from that good and dead in sin, is not able by his own strength to convert himself or to prepare himself thereunto. So here, what we have is we're looking at the dangers of Arminianism, and we're seeing that a man's will is determined by his ability. So he's free to choose good or evil. That's the freedom of the will. But he's unable to choose any saving good because by nature he hates God and he loves sin. And the will is never neutral. It's never able to act to contrary to itself. So Romans 3, 10 through 18, and Romans 8, 7. Paul says in Romans 8, 7 that it's averse to God, unable to please him. Ephesians 2, dead in sins and trespasses. Shorter Catechism 82, no mere man since the fall is able in this life perfectly to keep the commandments of God, but doth daily break them in thought, word, and deed. And they're unable to convert themselves. So they're addressing Arminianism on the one hand. They're also addressing a form of preparationism, or Arminianism, that says you can, or Romanism as well, that if you exercise your will to a certain level, God then will give you grace to go further toward Christ. So that's, you see, that grows out of total depravity. Total depravity has affected the whole person. Thus, every person who is unconverted freely does what he or she chooses. You need to understand that. And nobody has the will of contrary nature. Can God sin?
No.
Can God lie?
No.
Does God have free will?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So we can take God again as the model. God is going to act according to his nature, and the sinner is going to act according to his or her nature. Now, in the next paragraph, we come to the regenerate. When God converts a sinner and translates him into the state of grace, he frees him from his natural bondage under sin, and by his grace alone enables him freely to will and do that which is spiritually good. Now, when it says earlier that he cannot will any spiritual good, doesn't mean that a natural man cannot do good things, socially good things, civilly good things, morally good things. The chapter on good works will come to that and addresses the same issue. They're all sin. Augustine called them splendid sins. But he can make good decisions with nothing with respect to salvation. Whereas the converted man is freely to will to do that which is spiritually good. Yet so is that by reason of his remaining corruption, he doth not perfectly nor only will that which is good, but doth also will that which is evil. So the Apostle Paul laments, that which I ought not to do, I do; that which I ought to do, I don't do. That's the warfare that God in his wisdom left within us, a remnant of sin. So Paul says that the flesh, and that's the word he uses for the remnant of sin, lust against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh. Now that's very comforting. We have the Holy Spirit in us doing this battle. And he quickens us, and he enables us. And that's what mortification is. It's putting to death daily that remnant of sin that is in us. So we are able to choose good and not to sin, but we are not completely able. Yes, sir.
When Paul says that it's no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells in me. What does he mean that it's not I that do it? Because it's I that needs to confess.
Well, he's saying that the remnant of sin that's in him is what is affecting I, the choice that he's willed. So he's not saying he didn't will to do it, but he's saying it's not what he wants to do. It's not his new nature. Another thing that we see here is that it's not that we have two natures. You've heard the evangelical thing, you've got a white dog and a black dog, and whichever one you feed the most today will prevail. No, we only have one nature. It's a bad anthropology. We have a new nature, but it's got a remnant of corruption, and that's where the warfare takes place. So all Paul's emphasizing is that, yes, I'm a new man in Christ, that's the I, but I've got this remnant of sin in me that I must fight against, and sometimes I'm going to make decisions according to it. John Murray's very good on that in his book, Principles of Conduct. He has a chapter on the Civil War, the war that's taking place.
So just trying to clarify, so as a converted person, we desire to please God, but when we sin, because of our remaining sin or indwelling sin, corrupt nature, so we still sin according to our will, not being compelled.
Right.
Okay. Right. So when we said that homosexual people, they cannot find any excuse as if they were compelled, this principle applies to both Christian and
mm-hmm.
non-Christian.
Mm-hmm.
Even if they are still in bondage to sin.
Well, the difference is, because of their bondage to sin, they're going to choose sin. They're freely choosing sin.
But still freely, instead of being compelled, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's a necessity of nature,
mm-hmm.
Not a necessity outside them or some other force at work in them.
But can we say that, probably that they are forced by their sinful nature?
No, they choose
they
according
choose.
To their sinful. That's what
okay.
this
they
paragraph
choose.
3 says.
If we say forces, if they have no responsibility, right?
Paragraph 2. They're responsible, completely responsible. And they do what they want to do.
Does man in his natural state have the power of contrary choice?
No. I'm saying that. Only in the pre-fall state and in heaven. Regenerate state has the power of contrary choice. But not natural state. Depraved man. Just as God
okay,
has
that,
God has no power of contrary choice.
Okay.
What do you mean by contrary choice?
He cannot choose against his nature.
Okay.
But we sometimes choose against our nature.
I said that the regenerate man does have a power of contrary choice.
So is our will now, as those who are regenerate, in the same state it was in Adam and Eve before the fall?
No, because they were able not to sin.
But we're able not to sin as those who are regenerate, or at least in each choice that we make.
Yeah, no, we're not. We're able not to sin, but we're not free from sin. Look again at the language. When God converts a sinner and translates him to the state of grace, he frees him from his natural bondage under sin, and by his grace alone enables him freely to will and do that which is spiritually good, yet so as that by reason of his remaining corruption he doth not perfectly nor only will that which is good, but doth also will that which is evil. And so the regenerate is going, you don't sin unless you will to do it. That's the whole thing.
Well, that Adam and Eve willed to sin.
Right, but they were completely free. They had no corruption within them. We, because of our remaining corruption, we are not free from all sin.
And so this is a question I've had for a while, is if our decisions or our will is based upon our nature and our heart, you know, the Lord says, or Christ says, that our actions flow from our heart, and so we sin because we have corruption in our heart, but Adam and Eve didn't have corruption in their heart, then why did they sin?
Well, I tried to answer that question last week.
I must not remember.
My broomstick.
All right, yeah.
So God, anything finite must constantly be upheld by God, physically or morally. And God, there are no compulsion to uphold any creature to assist their will by grace. So because of finiteness, if God removes just a bit of his favor, then the person's going to fall. But that's because we'll always depend upon the grace of God.
So do we say that the ultimate reason for Adam and Eve to make the sinful choice is because God sovereignly removes some grace from them?
So yeah.
Of course, they are still responsible.
Right. They still did what they wanted to do. And this is merely a kind of faint theory of how a person with a morally upright nature and no remnant of sin could ever act against their nature. So Dabney uses the figure of a candle. You don't have to do anything but leave it alone and it goes out. And I use the broomstick. We won't have any fires. Literal fires. All right. Man, we've had fun, haven't we?
Dr. Biden.
Mr. Dotson.
Sorry, it's not Mr. Dotson. It's Justin Salinas from...
Oh, Justin. I should have heard that Hispanic accent.
Yeah. So my question is, in this concept of contrary choice, is that the same type of thing as, I guess in extreme cases, apostasy, or is that to be held in different light altogether?
Well, no. Apostasy takes place in a natural person who has given the appearance, as John says, of being with us, but by leaving manifested they were not of us. So the apostate is just acting according to his depraved nature.
Okay.
Is that what you're asking?
Yeah. So what is the, I guess that it creates another question of, I guess, how far does the contrary choice have the ability to go?
In the natural man, nowhere. A person who apostatized hasn't lost his salvation. He was never converted. So he's only acted, as it says, he can will non-saving good things. But he cannot will anything that's saving. So he can be in the church, he could love doctrine, everything else, and appear to love Christ, but he doesn't. That's the difference. So the regenerate person can backslide, but never permanently fall away. So yes, he could make a contrary choice because we do have within us that remnant of sin, but we will never permanently fall away.
So it's the belief that they will always come back.
Right.
To this.
If they're truly converted, they will always be restored.
Okay. Thank you.
All right, 5 minutes. Okay. Glad y'all are having fun. Hey, Fabio, I know it's your birthday, but I did call the class to order. Unless you want to share with all of us.
The reason I asked him my question was to not get the class in order.
Oh, we'll have to finish it later then, huh? If it's pertinent.
Yes, it is.
Let me decide. Last week.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's why I didn't ask it again.
Okay. That's good. You may ask me later. All right. So, Johan asked about John Murray's preferred phrase is free agency. There's really no difference in free will and free agency. I just think free will does get to the matter of that faculty by which the soul acts. And yes, the soul that acts in that way is a free agent. What we're opposed to is contrary choice or autonomy.
So in the regenerate man,
free not to sin, but not able not to sin.
And then in glory, the will of man is made perfectly and immutably free to do good alone in the state of glory only. So then we will only will that which is consistent with God and his holy purposes. All right. So as not to confuse too much, we'll go back now to covenant. I did have free will in this lesson, but I think it might even flow better related to the fall. So we begin with the fact of the. I gotta go back. Necessity of the covenant. And definition. The distance between God and the creature is so great that although reasonable creatures do obedience unto him as their creator, yet they could never have any fruition of him as their blessedness and reward, but by some voluntary condescension on God's part, which he hath been pleased to express by way of covenant. So we start here with the necessity of covenant, that is a sovereign condescension on the part of God. He's transcendent and holy. And it would be impossible for man to have any kind of personal relationship to God simply by right of creation. Now there's two, well, I think they're errors that are exposed here. One is that the Trinity is a covenant, and thus all the Trinity is doing is making covenant with us. The covenant is an act of intimacy. The Trinity loves itself perfectly. A covenant is the bond by which a friendship is established. Put it that way. The general definition of covenant that I give is it is a sovereignly administered bond with stipulations and sanctions. So a sovereignly administered bond means there's a covenant maker and a covenant receiver. It's done sovereignly on God's part. It binds man into a relationship with God. It has stipulations, which means requirements. It has sanctions, which would include either threats or promises. So that'll vary in what we call the covenant of works and the covenant of grace. But God is under no obligation to reveal himself to man in that way. Moreover, others say that by the act of creation, God entered into a covenant. But no, that's not what we find in Scripture either. The covenant came subsequent to man being made in the image of God. Thornwell has a very good discussion, and the others that have followed him, or he probably has followed others as well, that by creation, man as a moral creature was obligated to keep all of God's law. Under God's moral government, the moment he broke God's law, he would be damned. Now, without any covenant, that means you could have 1,000 people on the earth, you could have lived 1,000 years, and 1,000 year one, you broke one of God's commandments, you'd be damned. Because as God's moral law, you're only under God's justice. Solemn, holy, just requirements. So you have a race of people, half of which are damned and half of which are still obeying, but they might disobey tomorrow. And I say that so you'll understand the beauty of the covenant of works when we get to it. But by nature, God owed man nothing. That's why we owe him obedience as creator. And could never have any fruition, no blessedness of that relationship. That's what I've just tried to spell out for you. And reward. by some voluntary condescension on God's part. Now, basically, this is understood by most writers as that all covenants are an act of God's grace. Now, some prefer to use grace only with respect to sin, so that when God does not judge a sinner according to the merits of sin, he's exercised grace. That's true. But condescension is merely God giving to something which we do not deserve, which is surely a good way to think about grace. And John Meredith Klein hates the concept of grace, or he hated the concept, he knows better now, hated the concept of grace in this first covenant. One day in a faculty meeting, he was off on this. I said, but the confession says that it was an act of voluntary condescension. He said, I don't care what the confession says. There's no grace there. He was purely on merit. Now, it had to be covenanted merit, but it was merit. So, but that's not what the confession says. So anytime God opens himself up and enters into a relationship with a creature, that has got to be an act of grace. And the only way that God does that is by covenant. And we're covenant people, then, aren't we? Our whole lives are structured in this way. So, God has done this by acting in two covenants. So we have the covenant of works, paragraph 2, and actually larger catechism 20. What was the providence of God toward man in the estate in which he was created? The providence of God toward man in the estate in which he was created was placing him in paradise, appointing him to dress it, giving him liberty to eat of the fruit of the earth, putting the creatures under his dominion, and ordaining marriage for himself, affording him communion with himself, instituting the Sabbath, entering into a covenant of life with him upon condition of personal, perfect, perpetual obedience, of which the tree of life was a pledge, and forbidding to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil upon pain of death. So paragraph 2, the first covenant made with man was a covenant of works, wherein life was promised to Adam and in him to his posterity upon condition of perfect and personal obedience. So it's called a covenant of works. It's also called a covenant of life in Shorter Catechism 12 and in Larger Catechism 20. And it's also called the covenant of creation. So it was made with man in his pre-fall created state. It was a covenant that promised life. The traditional term, though, covenant of works, simply this is the condition. This was the stipulation in the covenant, which was for, as it's spelled out in Larger Catechism, personal, perfect, and perpetual obedience. So personal obedience, Adam had to obey. And all of us since then are responsible to obey. It must be perfect obedience, and it must be perpetual. Yes, sir.
Are you, in light of that, are you saying that if Adam had broken the Sabbath, he would have also been damned?
Good. Thank you. I'm going to talk about that. So that in the covenant of works, there is a context of the covenant of works that we have to think about. So I'm just giving you definitions now. Covenant of life, covenant of works. So it's called a covenant of works because that is the stipulation that is required. And there's an element of merit in the covenant of works, but it is what we would call covenantal merit. So life could not be earned by Adam by simply obeying God, unless God had covenanted that upon that probation, keeping that probationary commandment and the other commandments, God would give eternal life. I use the analogy that you ask a child to do something, and if they do it at their level that you agreed on, you reward them. Now, it's not done to the level that somebody else could have done it, but if you agree they do this, you reward them, then you've made a covenant with them, and you reward them on the basis of covenant. That's what we have in the covenant of works, of the covenant of life, or the covenant of creation. Yes, sir.
Dr. Piper, what would you say to those who, because of course, you know, the confession is going to say that the covenant of works ended in the garden. What would you say to those who would say that, no, the covenant of works did not end there necessarily, but the law would be underneath the covenant of works as well? Owens, of course, taught something.
Well, let's
like
get
that.
There, okay? So, God made the covenant.
Pipe.
He starts laughing every time.
Yes, sir.
Just one quick question on the language of merit. I don't know who said this, but I've heard it termed in the covenant of works, Adam enters into an agreement with God to maintain his righteousness, because the eating of the fruit of the tree was something that simply he wasn't allowed to do, so there was no positive duty. I've heard that somewhere. Can you elucidate that or correct that thought or respond to it?
I'd love to correct it. And I'm going to get there. No, that's important. And that, whoever told you that, way off the reservation. So, God comes to Adam in a context that he has moral responsibilities. And so, we need to distinguish the condition of the covenant, which was not to eat of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, and the moral context of the covenant into which Adam enters into his covenant with God. And that is, as it's spelled out in the larger catechism, he's in paradise, he's been given these responsibilities, he is in communion with God, he has marriage, he has the Sabbath, he has as well the law of God, as I said last week, written on his heart. We don't know what all God revealed to him verbally as well. We have the things in Genesis chapter 2. The entire moral law was incumbent upon Adam. So, yes, if he had broken one of those commandments, he would have sinned. But see, here's the difference. This is the beauty of the plan. He would not have broken the moral law, because it was written on his heart. And it was his nature. So, the test is given in terms of a positive law. There was nothing moral or immoral about that tree. It was a tree that God arbitrarily set aside in the center of the garden and said, "Of this tree you shall not eat." Now, why a positive law? Because Adam needed to be tested in his will. If it were a moral law, he simply reflexively would have chosen it. But now he must decide either to serve God or to serve himself and Satan over something that had no innate moral attraction to him. It was morally neutral. It was God's word that set it aside. And simply to fast forward, that's the significance of Christ in the garden, saying, "Not my will, but your will be done." There the second Adam is faced again with the choice of the will to break the covenant or to keep the covenant, and he kept the covenant. So it all fits together. It's a grand and glorious story. So if there's two views, I tend to go towards Thornwell on this and the Scotsman. Adam was created a servant, and he would maintain that state by obedience. If he disobeyed, then, as I said, he'd come under God's moral judgment. God was promising Adam and us in Adam justification and adoption, sonship. The servant would become the son of God. That would be the reality of the communion and of life that we would have with God. We don't know at what point, how many thousands of years, whatever, Adam might live on the earth. He might then have been translated into another state, or God, when he filled up the whole number of those that would save, have been established his presence permanently on earth. Maybe would have originally, we don't know. But Adam would have been a justified adopted son, and all of us descending from Adam would have been justified and adopted sons and daughters, unable to lose that. So that's a lot different from saying whatever it was you quoted, Mr. Dodson. See the difference?
Well, Yes, sir, but I do disagree with you. I think Adam was created a son.
That's fine. I was going to say that was Gerardo's position. He was a son, but now he would be confirmed as a son. He was a servant son, so to speak, in the created state. So I was going to give it, but I'm talking about that crazy thing you said about righteousness and everything.
Yeah, I think it came from Edward Bowles.
Say it again.
Edward Bowles?
No, say it again what you had heard or read.
That Adam, in the covenant of works, simply had the duty to maintain his righteousness by not eating of the tree. So there was no positive command, it was simply maintenance of a righteous state.
But it has to be a positive command. How can he maintain his righteousness by not eating of the tree?
Because...
there had to be a commandment.
I think the argument would go, it's because he wasn't inclined to eat, but I might have misunderstood it. When you get into like mold, you get into some weird things.
I don't know him.
He wrote a volume on justification that Burkhoff really liked. He was a German neo-Calvinist, was famous for critiquing Rachel, as well as getting in a big dispute with Abraham Kuyper, which I do admire him for disputing with Kuyper.
Okay, let's put it this way. I could regather my train of thought. Part of the idea of the positive command, this was a probation, and it was very limited in time. It was going to be a test of the will. It wasn't a permanent test, which is what this would imply. Now, this was a limited time posted, not that Adam knew the time, but it was limited in God's mind, a specific period of time. Again, that's what the whole test depends upon. That's how what the temptation exposes. Furthermore, if it were not a limited time, it wouldn't be a true probation. And you could eventually have had children that would be moral creatures now living under a covenant that could actually turn them into immoral beings. And so it was limited. The focus was the test with respect to the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Call that simply because Adam would either determine that what God says was evil, what God said was good, or he would listen to other sources. He declared his autonomy and listened to Satan and asserted his own will, and he fell. Now, the justice of it is the most beautiful place. He was walking, having communion with God, and it was going to preserve life for all people. Would you like to just go one-on-one with God the rest of your life? And the first day you messed up, then you get destroyed? None of us would have survived that. Hope we don't think that highly of ourselves.
Adam's our perfect representative.
He was a perfect representative, and he was in the best of all possible worlds. And it was a gracious act on God's part to say, it's a simple test, Adam, and you do this, and you and your posterity will have eternal life.
Dr. Pipa, how does the probationary idea interact with this idea of perpetual obedience? Is perpetual meaning something other than unending or...
No, it does. But, I mean, that's the thing. The obedience must continue, but it would. To his posterity upon condition of perfect and personal obedience. So that we must, as covenant, even now in the new covenant, we're required to personal, perpetual, personal, perfect, perpetual, and perfect, personal, and perpetual obedience. That doesn't change. So we get to chapter 19 in the law, we're going to be reminded the law demands that, and that gets to this question in terms of the ongoing effects of the covenant of grace. Thank you. The covenant of works as a covenant for mankind is no longer in existence, because the covenant head has sinned. Christ, as we see in just a minute now, will have kept the covenant of works and saved us both by fulfilling its positive demands and paying its penalty. Mankind is born under the curse and obligation of the covenant of works, so all people are required to obey God perfectly, perpetually, and personally. And not to do so means you're damned. And that's a very good place to begin with a gospel presentation. If you want to go to heaven, the Bible says you must obey God personally, perfectly, and perpetually. Have you done that? Well, no. Well, then you can't go to heaven. But God did it for you. And then you direct them to Christ. So that it's not a covenant of works, because you cannot earn life for anybody else. But you're responsible to earn life for yourself and can't.
So follow up with that. If those are the requirements of the covenant that even Christ had to fulfill, how can we speak of Christ having fulfilled that requirement? Do we have to continue speaking of him as even now perpetually fulfilling the covenant of works? It seems to me that would be wrong.
No, he's
finished it.
He's finished it. And because he's an eternal, infinite being, okay. There is...
So that's part of the necessity of his divinity and fulfilling the covenant is being able to meet that perpetual requirement even in time.
So paragraph 3, man by his fall having made himself incapable of life by that covenant, the Lord was pleased to make a second, commonly called the covenant of grace, wherein he freely offers unto sinners life and salvation by Jesus Christ, requiring of them faith in him that they may be saved, and promising to give unto all those that are ordained unto eternal life his Holy Spirit, to make them willing and able to believe. And then, Larger Catechism 31. Well, let's do 30. God doth not leave all men to perish in the state of sin and misery, into which they fell by breach of the first covenant, commonly called the covenant of works. But of his mere love and mercy, delivers his elect out of it. So we're looking back now. We've gone back to the fall and the covenant headship of Adam. Now back to election. Delivereth the elect out of it and brings them into an estate of salvation by a second covenant. It's commonly called the covenant of grace. Now why is it called the covenant of grace? The grace of God is manifested in the second covenant. The grace of God is manifested in the second covenant in that he freely provideth and offereth to sinners a mediator, and life and salvation by him, requiring faith as the condition to interest them in him, promiseth and giveth his Holy Spirit to all his elect, to work in them that faith with all other saving graces, and to enable them unto all holy obedience as evidence of the truth of their faith and thankfulness to God, and as the way which he hath appointed them to salvation. So there are those that say, since the covenant of grace is not language of the Bible, that we shouldn't use it, but this is explaining why. It's of grace. It provides grace for us. And then, with whom is the covenant of grace made? 31. Christ as the second Adam, and in him all the elect as his seed. Now, we're not going to go here tonight. When you get 3 years from now, 2.5 years from now, whatever it is, to Christ and salvation, now that'll be your senior year, first semester. We'll get into the Reformed difference of opinion on this, and I guess Dr. McGraw will probably get into prolegomena first. The covenant of grace was made with Christ as the covenant head and his elect in him. Administrations of it then take place throughout time through the church, but he's the covenant head and the covenant keeper, and as we are in him by faith, that we are saved. But notice he also offers not just life, but he offers the very, he requires faith, but he provides faith. So there's also a discussion, is covenant conditional or unconditional? It's conditional in that you must believe the Lord Jesus Christ. You must walk in holiness. But it's unconditional because Christ not only fulfilled all the conditions, but has purchased for us everything. So the way the Catechism puts it, to work in them that faith with all other saving graces, and to enable them unto all holy obedience as the evidence of the truth of their faith and thankfulness to God, and as the way which he appointed them to salvation. And so again, justification is by faith alone. Salvation is through endurance. You must persevere in the way. That's why it uses the language obedience as truth of their faith and thankfulness to God, and as the way which he hath appointed them to salvation. An unholy man or woman who's lived any period of time on the face of the earth is not a Christian. Because Christ has purchased all these things for us in the covenant of grace. And so when the confession uses salvation, we'll see a number of instances, it's referring to the whole ball of wax, including our glorification, not simply our conversion or our justification. So the parties are the triune God, Christ, in prospect of his incarnation, and the elect sinner. The promises of salvation, to be saved from sin, eternal life, the Holy Spirit, speed this up a bit. Let's look at paragraph 4. What is meant by this? The covenant of grace is frequently set forth in Scripture by the name of a testament in reference to the death of Jesus Christ, the testator, and to the everlasting inheritance with all things belonging to it therein bequeathed. Now, there have been those that have said that the whole thing's patterned after a will, and that Christ had to die in order for the effects of the will to go into effect, and that's how they define the new covenant and testament. That's not what this paragraph means. This paragraph means that there is a testamentary character to the covenant of grace. So that the word that's used to translate the Hebrew word bereath is diatheke. The common Greek word for covenant was syntheke, and that means a mutual agreement. Diatheke means a sovereignly imposed arrangement with blessing. In Syrian Eastern culture, an heir, such as in the prodigal son, could receive the inheritance before the death of the testator. Whereas in Roman law, you could not receive the inheritance until the death of the testator. The New Testament is functioning on this first thing. So when it says that frequently testament, diatheke, is used to the death of Christ and the testator, it means and the everlasting inheritance. Because of Christ's death, the inheritance belongs to us. And it's now. That we are participating in this inheritance that Christ has and purchased for us. And so there's a good section in Burkhoff and in Turretin defending this language, not the idea that it's patterned after a death when the will is opened up. No, the will is showing the certainty of the promise of the eternal inheritance that we now have. Then we have the administration of the covenant. In paragraph 5, the covenant was differently administered. So we talk about the Adamic covenant, the Noahic covenant, the Abrahamic covenant, the Mosaic covenant, the Davidic covenant, the New Covenant. We're not talking about different covenants. In fact, we're not even talking about the covenant per se. We're talking about the administration of the covenant. The covenant's made with Christ and his elect in him. The covenant then has this eternal aspect about it, and it's those in the covenant are in fact in the body of Christ, the invisible church. But God has chosen to administer the covenant through the church through periods of progressive covenant revelation. And that's why we have these different administrations, each one building on the other. But you need to understand that each new administration rejects nothing in the previous administration. Everything is carried over and added to, for there's new light. So look at what it says. In the time of the law, and that's just the broad term, refer to the old covenant period before Christ, and the time of the gospel differently administered. So, in the time of the law, promises, prophecies, sacrifices, circumcision, paschal lamb, other types and ordinances delivered to the people of the Jews, all for signifying Christ to come, which were for that time sufficient and efficacious through the operation of the Spirit to instruct and build up the elect in faith in the promised Messiah. Not some vague faith like evangelicals say. They believed in the Savior to come. You see this if you read that section in Calvin. By whom they had full remission of sins and eternal salvation. It's called the Old Testament. But now notice, we've got all of this put together because these parts, different parts, the circumcision, the Paschal lamb, the ordinances, the types, all of that. All this was building and all picturing God's gracious dealing with his people. But you need to understand it's one covenant. And this is what my Baptist friends need to understand. It's one covenant. It's not five different covenants. The same principle is always operating in the covenant. Every covenant from Adam on was made with the believer and his children, knowing that some of those children were not elect. So it was the believer and his seed. So in Adam, Abel, Seth, became regenerate people. Cain was reprobate. Noah, Shem, and Japheth, regenerate people. Ham was reprobate. Abraham, Isaac was regenerate. Ishmael not. Esau not regenerate. Jacob regenerate. You go right on down. The Mosaic covenant, the church perished in the wilderness. Paul works this out. Covenants made with them, but the great majority of them fell in the desert. The Davidic covenant, there was a righteous seed, but there was a wicked seed. So you understand that the covenant, in every one of its administrations, always included the believer and his seed, knowing that all of the seed was not regenerate. Now why, when you get to the new covenant, which what we have is a continual expansion, so you start with the promise of the seed, supernaturally provided seed and sacrifices, and each stage is adding new things, but never does away with anything in the previous covenant. So why in the world, when you get to the new covenant, which now fulfills all of this, it's not done away with willy-nilly, but it's all coming down to its perfect form in Christ, why would you do away with believers and their seed? It's kind of foreign to the entire experience of God's people throughout the millennium. And that's why it's important to note it's one covenant, administered one way in the old covenant, but with great consistency. Faith was always the way to enter into the covenant. Obedience was always the way to persevere in the covenant. That continues. I don't like the hymn greatly, but trust and obey gets to the truth. There's no other way, not to be right with God, but to walk with God than to trust and obey.
Two questions. So I have friends who talk about the Noah covenant, and they talk about how that covenant is a covenant made with all people, not the church. That sits with me wrong.
Good.
Because if it's the covenant of grace, then God's only making his promises to the church.
It is made with the church and the world, but it's made with the church because the whole dynamic going on there is what God is showing. The very reason he gives for never again destroying the race as he did in Genesis 8:20 is the same reason he destroyed the race. The hearts of man is extremely deceitful and sinful. So what he showed in the Noahic covenant was his justice and judgment are in the flood. But if he dealt with the human race that way, there'd be no opportunity for the purposes of grace to operate. So God makes a covenant that he will never again destroy the world. He brings stability to it. But out of that, he's creating the environment for the unfolding of grace. And thus, I have a chart that I use in the Christ and Salvation class. And so Genesis 3:15 is the plot. The Noahic covenant is the environment, the stage. And so that's where God is promising to preserve the race and the creation. And then in Jeremiah, twice, the stability of the creation is used to enforce the promises of grace. It's always been one in God's mind. So yes, it does include a stability in the world, but and it's also established a civil government, because if God's not going to destroy sinners again, there needs to be then a form of restraining sin manually, so to speak, as well. But no, there are those that say that. Republication people want to say that.
That was my other question. How would you address somebody who basically purports Klein's argument about how
I can't do that tonight. I've got a paper I can give you that I wrote. Okay. But, somebody up there?
I was just wondering, could you say that the Noahic covenant is made with the world for the sake of the church?
No, it's made with the church, and it includes the world for the sake of the church, is what I want to say.
Okay. That's
so when I see a rainbow, and you should do this, when I see a rainbow, I am reminded that God is faithfully preserving all things to accomplish the purposes of grace. So when he says, I'll look on the rainbow and remember my covenant, that's covenantal language. So remember in Exodus 2, children of Israel were in bondage in Egypt, and it says God remembered his covenant. And that just means he's going to act. And so every time he gives us a rainbow, he's reminding us of his faithfulness. And you look at Jeremiah, that the surety of the covenant of the new covenant is as sure as the seasons that pass, the sun that's in the sky. And the rainbow is over. Another reason I think it's a covenant of grace, where does the rainbow next appear in Scripture? Over the throne of God in Revelation 4. All right. In the new covenant, under the gospel, when Christ, the substance, was exhibited, the ordinances in which this covenant is dispensed are the preaching of the word and the administration of the sacraments of baptism and the Lord's Supper, which though fewer in number and administered with more simplicity and less outward glory, yet in them it is held forth in more fullness, evidence, and spiritual efficacy. To all nations, that's the difference, both Jews and Gentiles, and it's called the New Testament. There are not therefore two covenants of grace differing in substance, but one and the same under various dispensations. And that's basically what's summarized then in Larger Catechism 33, 34, and 35. So any questions about the covenant? Not more advanced questions, but basic questions.
So how would you interpret the passage in Galatians then, which is talking about the allegory of Hagar being the old covenant and then Sarah being the new covenant? So,
the allegory is illustrating the abuse of the old covenant. So that's what Paul's addressing. If you use the law in the wrong way, you're creating bondage.
What do it mean for a man to become like God, knowing good and evil? I've heard some expound that to mean that man now believed that he could determine what was good and evil for himself.
Well, he did try to determine that. I think God's being a bit sarcastic. It's not above him or below him. We just looked at 2 Corinthians. I take that as sarcasm. Or that man vaunted himself so that he knows good and he's become like us. And that's what he's asserting. So he asserts his autonomy, and because he asserts his autonomy, yeah, that's what he thinks he's done.
How do we answer the objection about the new covenant still carrying forward the seed of the believer when our brothers would bring up Jeremiah 31, they will all know?
Well, I think the Bible answers that question. 1 John 2 interprets that as having to do with the anointing of the Spirit, and it actually refers that passage. What God's commanding in the New Covenant is not only to regenerate. I mean, in the Old Covenant, he regenerated, but he didn't pledge himself to regenerate. Here he's pledging himself that within the covenant, he is going to write his law on the hearts of all those with whom it's made. That doesn't mean all who are under its administration are those with whom it is made. Why would that principle change? So what God's promising is to those who are elect that we're going to have superior privileges to the Old Covenant people. I put it this way the other day. In the Old Covenant, the remnant was the converted, and it was a remnant, wasn't it? In the New Covenant, the remnant are the unconverted. That's the swap. Majority of the people now in true churches are converted, at least when the church is healthy. whereas then the majority of the people in the church were unconverted. But today it's so because God has covenanted to change our hearts and to give us the Holy Spirit. We have the Holy Spirit in a way they did not have.
What do you mean by in the church? There were unbelievers in the church.
Are there?
I thought that's what you just said.
Yeah, there are, aren't there?
Sure.
Are you in a perfect church? If so, I want to join it. Of course, that wouldn't help it. But
you're talking about the church.
Yeah, that's the only place the covenant's administered. I'm talking about the administration of the covenant. I said all the elect are in the invisible church, and they own it. But the visible church has always included believers in their seed. And not all the seed are regenerate. But the difference is now we expect the great majority of those who've been properly received in the church by a credible profession of faith with their children to be converted. So it should be the exception.
Would you agree that that is the case, like in an established church that's in good shape? So, like 1647 Church of Scotland, would you say the majority of those people were converted or Puritan New England? Because I'm just wondering, because with establishment, you bring in kind of a different flavor to it, as it were.
Well, yeah, establishment creates a whole different problem. That is, everybody, it's a state church, and And so I'm not keen on the establishmentarian principle, but you could still have that principle that you have one state church, but you're not automatically a member of it until you are received properly by the officers, which is what at least early on they tried to protect, say in Scotland in the 17th century. It wasn't because I'm a member of this village, I'm a member of the church.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yes, sir. Well, see, that's the test. But he wasn't tested in terms of the first commandment. He was tested in terms of this positive commandment, which violated all 10 of the commandments. So we won't go into that now.
Okay.
But no, it does violate all of God's law. But he violated it at this test. If he had simply been challenged about idolatry, he wouldn't have sinned. But he committed idolatry because his will was challenged about something that, which he didn't have an innate resonating with.
So the discussion is more is about the way he was tested, not the things he seen about, right?
I'm sorry, I didn't understand.
I'm sorry, I'll think about that.
The test was not to eat the tree of knowledge of good and evil. That was testing his heart, his will. Is he going to obey God? The moment he disobeyed God, he was an idolater. And he was not being ruled by God's word. He took God's name in vain. He, by not resting in God, he broke the Sabbath. He didn't obey God, he broke the fifth commandment. He murdered the entire human race. Sexual discord entered into his marriage. He stole, he bore false witness, and he coveted. But it was that, and again, that's the wisdom of the commandment that God knew by testing his will, which would show whether he was going to have perfect, perpetual, personal, perpetual, and perfect obedience. Now, I did skip over the tree of life. The tree of life was a sacrament. Now, some people call the tree of the knowledge of good and evil a sacrament as well, but I think that's quite erroneous. So again, we see what would have happened. It wasn't a magical tree. It wasn't if he ate the tree that he would be confirmed. That's not what God is saying when he expels man from the garden. He's simply saying that he would try to earn life by his works. There'd be right back, things would be worse. He must live now by faith. The tree of life was a tree. It's just like the Lord's Supper. If Adam ate of that tree, reminded him of God's promise, and of his responsibility, his faith would have been strengthened. So again, we call it the covenant of works, but faith is the operating principle. There's never obedience apart from faith. And so faith was just as active in that covenant as it would be in now the covenant of grace, except the stipulation was different. It's faith alone to enter into the covenant of grace. It was faith that obeyed that kept the covenant of grace. But now, how do you keep the covenant of grace? Faith and obedience. You don't ever without obedience, you see.
So faith preceded works without...
I think so.
Another question, which might be a little bit hypothetical. What would have happened if Adam had not listened to Eve and he did not sin?
The only thing that could have happened is that God would have destroyed Eve and made Adam a new wife.
Destroyed Eve?
Yeah, he would have to. Okay. She sinned, she died. But the race didn't die in her sin, you see. So the race would still come from a perfect wife with Adam. And so, because she's made from him, even if she were made after he obeyed and kept the covenant, she would have been made confirmed to perfection.
He's got a lot more ribs.
Got a lot more what?
Ribs.
They all grow back. That's the only thing that grows back. All right. Any other questions about the covenant?
I heard about another term, it's a covenant of redemption.
Yeah, I was trying to avoid that.
Okay.
That is the other view, that there was three covenants, a covenant of works, a covenant of redemption made between the Trinity and Christ, that he was not the head, the covenant head, he came as the mediator of the covenant, and the covenant of grace that is made with the elect. So in the day, there's not a lot of difference, but I think the language of the catechism keeps that parallel of covenant head. You lose that in this other three covenant series. But both of them would maintain that there was a covenant transaction in eternity with terms agreed to by the Father and the Son and the Spirit, or the Triune God and the Son and the Spirit as well. And the difference is that the Catechism would say that the covenant was made with Christ and the elect in Him. The covenant of redemption view would mean that on the basis of that transaction, God now makes covenant with the elect. So I prefer to think about a covenant grace with an eternal phase and an end time phase. Dr. McGraw, I think, would prefer to talk about three covenants.
So the covenant is basically made by the Father with the Son. And what role does the Spirit play?
That's beyond us today. It's a very important question. And either you can study or you can wait till your senior year.
Oh. So which chapter of the confession would deal with this?
I don't think, you've seen what the confession is going to say about it.
Okay.
Yeah. But you can get Dr. Smith's systematics or Burkhoff, and that'd be a good place to look at it. But we will talk about Christ now, the mediator of the covenant. It's not the geographical center of the standards, but it is the fulcrum. This is, for me, the high point of, we've moved from the Word to God, decree, creation and fall, covenant of grace, and then slipped in free will. But now the covenant of grace is made with Christ the mediator. Everything else now is going to flow out of this chapter. So everything else is coming up to it before now. And that's why Marie's book is entitled Redemption Accomplished and Applied. So chapter 8 of the confession, you can write right across the top of the chapter, Redemption Accomplished. And this is the objective work of God the Son in saving his people from their sins. The next chapter after free will is effectual calling, and that will be redemption applied. and basically the rest of the standards will look at redemption applied and at the practical Christian living. So we can get through a good portion of this, Lord willing. Paragraph 1, we've got the commissioning purpose and purpose of the mediator. It pleased God. Now, I don't think I've shown you this yet, but if you pay attention, what you have in these chapters is like these couples on train cars. They keep coupling one chapter to the next or to previous, just the way train cars. You know how train cars couple? So look, it pleased God in his eternal purpose. We're going right back now to chapter 3, to choose and ordain the Lord Jesus. So here's the election of the one, his only begotten Son, and we discussed that in chapter 2, to be the mediator between God and man. So because of sin, we had to have a go-between. The prophet, priest, and king, the head and savior of his church, the heir of all things and judge of the world, unto whom he did from eternity give a people to be his seed, there's the doctrine of election, and to be by him in time redeemed, called, justified, sanctified, and glorified. So car after car is just linked together, and you'll see this all the way through the Westminster Confession of Faith. So it's God's eternal purpose. 1 Peter 1:20, Acts 2:23, Christ was the first elect. In Isaiah, he's a servant of Jehovah. Isaiah 42:1, 1 Timothy 2:5, he's the only mediator between God and man. John 3:16, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish. Now, what does mediator mean? Okay, so what does the mediator do? Is he stands between us and the Father?
Communicate.
Lucas.
Takes our heart.
He appeases the anger or wrath of one party against another.
Okay, well, more broadly, a mediator is one that reconciles two opposed parties. I'm going to say, what does a mediator do? A mediator reconciles. I've got to go to Florida in the next 2 days. Lord willing, I'm going to be able to help arbitrate, mediate, reconcile. I think the Spirit's already begun some of that work. And so we'll pray that he'll continue to do that. So the mediator between God and man is the one that's going to reconcile man to God. And I'm going to deal with that actually in my sermon tomorrow in chapel. What does it mean to be reconciled to God? So he stands between the two. God has enmity toward us, and we have enmity toward him. But Christ removes God's enmity toward us, that God can then take away our enmity toward him. But God is the one that must be reconciled. His enmity must be turned away, and this was to be done by the mediator who bridged the gap, so to speak, put his hand on God's shoulder and man's shoulder and brought the two together, only by also being the, as we'll see, the propitiatory sacrifice. You couldn't just reconcile God to his enemies, who were wicked sinners who deserved hell. So, but that's what he's come to do. And he was given a people for whom to mediate. So we see that he, from all eternity, gave a people to be his seed. Here again is this concept of seed. I did it. Johann.
You've been protecting me.
It's just water. It's all right. Better there than on the pad. Now, to accomplish this, he, as a mediator, he was given specific offices. And so we're told here that he was appointed prophet, priest, and king. Now, the catechism is going to unpack this, these for us. And they're very important. They're necessary, though. Let me just give a little background at this point. Remember, Adam was created with knowledge, righteousness, and holiness. That means Adam was a prophet, priest, and king. When he lost those things, he lost this ability to relate to God or to govern the world as a prophet, priest, and king. And so the whole movement of the work of Christ is to restore us to knowledge, righteousness, and holiness, which means that we become now in renewal prophets, priests, and kings. Now, we don't have a prophethood of believers, but we do have a priesthood of believers, and we do have dominion exercises that we are to do as believers, and we are to know the mind of God as it's revealed in Scripture. And there's three other things in his work. He's the head and savior of the church, so he's been given as the head to the body, and thus its savior. He's the heir of all things, and this means he's the firstborn. All things belong to him by creation. All things belong to him by redemption. And he's the judge of the world. So our Savior is going to be our judge at the end of the day. The purpose of the mediator in paragraph one is what? To redeem,
call, justify, sanctify.
Call. Keep going.
Justify, sanctify.
There we go. All right. So as Redeemer says, remember as I said, redemption accomplished, redemption applied. He's going to redeem his elect. He's going to call them effectually. He's going to justify them, adopt them, sanctify them, and glorify them. That's all built into his work as mediator. So that's the general purpose that is spelled out with respect to Christ the mediator. And Calvin discusses the purpose in book 1, chapter 16, if you want to put that in your notes. He discusses the three offices in book 2, chapter 15. So that's the purpose. Now, paragraph 2 and paragraph 7 deal with the person of the mediator. So we have the purpose of the mediator, and now we have the person of the mediator. So we have the commission of the mediator, and then we got his offices, then his purpose, and now we got his person. So the Son of God, the second person of the Trinity, the very eternal God of one substance, equal with the Father. Where does that take you? You see these links? Chapter 2, did when the fullness of time was come take upon him man's nature with all essential properties and common infirmities thereof, yet without sin. Now, how did he do this? Being conceived by the power of the Holy Ghost in the womb of the Virgin Mary of her substance, so that two whole, perfect, and distinct natures, the Godhead and the manhood, were inseparably joined together in one person without conversion, composition, or confusion, which person is very God and very man, yet one Christ, the only mediator between God and man. So we begin with the assertion of what we saw in chapter 2, that he is a eternally divine person, the second person of the Godhead, equal in power and glory with the Father. Now we have the reality of the incarnation, which means the infleshedness of Christ. He took upon him man's nature. He did not take upon himself a human being. He took upon himself a human nature. So that, as we'll see in a moment, he's one person with two natures. He's not two persons. He's one person with two natures.
What is the difference between human nature and human being?
Well, I think I'll be able to explain it to you. Hang in there.
Okay.
All the essential properties. So what does a human nature have? It has a will, an intellect, it has affections. So he has all the essential properties of a human nature because he has a body and a soul. So he has everything that a human being has in his nature, but he does not have a human father, because he was born without sin. Now, common infirmities thereof as well. And we'll come back to those when we look at the humiliation of Christ. So I won't tarry there now. Yet without sin, he not only had no sin, he was incapable of sinning because of the union of the two natures in the one person. But it was by the Holy Ghost that he was conceived in the womb of the Virgin Mary of her substance. And so what would normally take place in God creating a child in the womb would be that the male sperm would fertilize the egg and all of that cell division would begin. The Holy Spirit took the egg of the Virgin Mary and made a human. He made a human with a human body, and wherever the soul comes from, whether it is created in each person or whether it's passed down, this would tend to look towards created, but I put the two together. I think it does. I think God takes the soul of the parents and makes the soul then for. So two things are going on. But anyway, in some way, I think he took Mary's soul here and made a sinless soul for Jesus, because the original sin is passed from the Father. That's why circumcision was so important in the Old Testament, and why women didn't need to be circumcised. Plus, it was a type of Christ. Now, sinful traits can be passed from the mother, personality traits and stuff like that. But in terms of the guilt of original sin, and that's that's why we talked about all those who descend from Adam by ordinary generation. That accepts this one. So he's given this nature. God was his father. His mother, Mary, was a human being, the daughter of Adam. And so he was completely God, Colossians 2:9, completely man, Luke 27:31. Now, a human being has a separate personality. Christ received, the human nature was taken into the divine person. And it was the Son of God that was the, they call it in hypostasis, that was the one who personalized the person. And so the personhood comes from the human nature. It's still just one, I mean, from the divine person. But there's still just the two natures. But the unifying element of the two is the person of God the Son. So he didn't take a human being, he took a human nature, and they became then in the one person. So it's the person who had a nature who takes another nature into his person, but not another person into his person.
So because human beings would include a person,
yeah.
Since Christ is only one person, so
right.
He only takes the human person instead of human being. Otherwise, he would have two persons.
Right, you got it. And that's, when we've got this language, it actually goes back to Chalcedon. So the two whole, perfect, and distinct natures, the Godhead and the manhood, were inseparably joined together in one person. This is called hypostatic union. So that means person. The personal union of the two natures, the hypostatic union. That's what the confession is teaching here, that the two whole perfect distinct natures, now notice they're distinct, the Godhead and the manhood were inseparably joined together, distinct but joined together, unified in one person. But notice, without conversion, composition, or confusion. Now this is picking up on what the council in Chalcedon was dealing with, is it had to deal with these various Christological heresies. So one of them had Christ having, it's almost two persons, and the good human being, this is Nestorianism, was eventually awarded with divinity. And so That is the idea of conversion. Eutychianism was the position that he had, but one nature, it was divine, and so you got this composition here. And then your confusion is you kind of get, well, it's just a new being. But see, all those things are wrong. It's always one person with two distinct natures, and he's very God and very man, yet one Christ. Here we get the one Christ, the only mediator between God and man. So that's kind of spelled out then in Larger Catechism 36. The only mediator of the covenant of grace is the Lord Jesus Christ, who being the eternal Son of God, of one substance, equal with the Father, in the fullness of time, that's language from Galatians 4, you remember, became man, and so was and continues to be God and man, and two distinct natures in one person forever. That's basically what we have in Short Catechism 21. And then paragraph 7 picks back up on this relationship of the two natures. It's page 44. Although the work of redemption was not actually wrought by Christ, excuse me, 7. Why are these things numbered so wrongly? Yeah, 38. Christ in the work of mediation, that's the work of mediator, acts according to both natures, by each nature doing that which is proper to itself. Yet by reason of the unity of the person, that which is proper to one nature is sometimes in Scripture attributed to the person, denominated by the other nature. So, could God shed blood or die?
No.
Okay. And yet Paul says in Acts 20:28, the church was purchased with the blood of God. So here you have the one person as the Redeemer. And in his work, sometimes he acts according to the human nature. This is why the two are joined together. Sometimes he has to act according to divine nature. They're both absolutely necessary. Let me see where I'm going to deal with that. They're both necessary. Watch Catechism 40. It was requisite that the mediator who was to reconcile God and man should himself be both God and man in this one person, the proper words of each might be accepted of God for us. So we have the questions, why did he have to be God? 38, page 35. It was requisite the mediator should be God, that he might sustain and keep the human nature from sinking under the infinite wrath of God and the power of death, give worth and efficacy to his sufferings, obedience and his sufferings, obedience and intercession, and to satisfy God's justice. Procure his favor, purchase a peculiar people, give his spirit to them, conquer all their enemies, and bring them to everlasting salvation. So, the divine nature was necessary to uphold the human under the wrath of God and to give eternal efficacy. A mere man couldn't atone for the sins of billions of people. He could maybe die for one if he were sinless and God agreed, but he'd go to hell. But because he was the infinite eternal person, in his divine nature, that gave efficacy then to everything he did as mediator. And as then 39, why did he have to be man? That he might advance our nature, perform obedience to the law, suffer and make intercession for us in our nature, have a fellow feeling of our infirmities, that we might receive the adoption of sons and have comfort and access with boldness upon unto the throne of grace. So, when I'm teaching this, I use two little S words. He had to be a suitable Savior. That means he had to be made like unto us. But he had to be a sufficient Savior. He had to have a divine nature to give efficacy. But it's the person who is doing all of these things. So
suitable.
We also have what's sufficient. And 7 is what we call then the communication of attributes. so that that which is proper on the one sometimes in Scripture attributed to the other, denominated by the other nature. So that is a communication of attributes. There is a Latin that communicatio idiomatum. So the communication, and then that's attributes.
Is there a way for us to distinguish between when he's acting and according to which nature, and or is that even a helpful thing to look for?
Well, when he died, he was obviously acting according to his human nature. When he was ignorant of the second coming, he was acting. But when he forgave sin, but it's still the person doing these things. Yeah, but I mean, there'll be times. I think when he exercised, only God can still a storm. So, but there is a question that points out the fact that it's in both natures that he has redeemed us. So that's put together, and I guess we've already read 40, to reconcile God and man. So we will pick up next week with the paragraph 3, the qualifications for his office of mediator, and then we'll look at his humiliation and exaltation and his work as prophet, priest, and king, and application. And then remember, we're doing effectual calling and justification, not adoption as well. So I think we'll come close to wrapping it up next week. Yes, sir?
When Christ was exercising miracles, was he acting according to his divine nature or his human nature by the help of the Spirit, or both?
Acting according to both. I mean, the work of the mediator was always the work of the person. But, obviously, when he's doing certain things, you'll see the predominance of the one nature or the other. So only God can forgive sin. Well, he proves he can forgive sin by healing the paralytic.
But miracles, even apostles, they are human beings, they could do so.
They couldn't forgive sin.
Yeah.
Right. Even the Pope can't forgive sin. He just thinks he can. Any more questions? I need to shut this thing down correctly this time. Alright, so first, you three, good night. Good night,
good night
Irene.
Thank you. Good night.
Lord willing, see you next week.
Thank you for watching this production of Greenville Presbyterian Theological Seminary. For more information, visit gpts.edu.